A head full of feathers. It's the kind of lifestyle. Never put anything back in the same place twice. Spend most of my time looking for my car keys. Turn up at the doctor's, the dentist, on the wrong day, wrong time. Forget hair appointments altogether. And for most of the time, the house is untidy and chaotic. It's an inability to complete one task before beginning another. My whole life, it would seem, is a senior moment. My photography works along the same lines. I hate carrying too much baggage, so I just usually take one camera and a lens, and quite often the following generally happens. Forget to charge or take a battery. Forget to replace the card after editing. Wished I'd taken a different lens. Wished again I brought my tripod. I hate it, and I'm sure it has a death wish for me. It knows my centre of gravity is not good and constantly tries to trip me up. I always had a camera of sorts, and in the 80s I purchased a Fuji Compact whilst we were on holiday in Germany. Although I don't think it was ever off auto, I was always pleased with the results. It was around this time I joined Galashiels Camera Club and had a degree of success in club competitions. Here are just one or two images I managed to save from some old transparencies taken from around this time. My claim to fame. I won the Morton Plate for best overall entry at what is now the Borders Digital Challenge. Does anybody remember when you used to mask your transparencies with tinfoil? An upgrade. Flush with success, I purchased a Canon EOS 100 along with two Tamron lens. A little later, a second body, an EOS 500. Don't ask me why I needed a second body. I just thought I needed one, and I still have them both up in the loft somewhere. I dipped my toe into some black and white processing. It wasn't without its frustrations. Not having any available space in the flat for a dark room, it was the garden shed. Although the setup wasn't ideal, I did have one or two successes. Here are just one or two images I've managed to dig out and scan from the prints that I have made. Interest begins to wane. I drifted away from photography when the next 8 years, most of my spare time was taken up showing and racing my three whippets. That came to a very abrupt end in 2001 with the outbreak of foot and mouth disease. On the subject of pets, I have to say it's a fallacy that owners begin to look like their pets. I had three lean racing machines and it didn't work for me. Although it does appear it works for some people. A renewed interest in photography was awakened with the discovery of digital. I was fortunate enough to have the loan of a little digital camera. After this, I just had to have my own. I became the proud owner of a Fuji FinePix 4700 Zoom circa 2000. I still use this little camera long after I'd purchased my first DSLR in 2010. It was just so easy to slip into a pocket when walking the dogs. I would probably still be using it now if I could get it 64 gigabytes of memory instead of 64 megabytes of memory. When I retired in 2007, I treated myself to a Panasonic bridge camera, an FZ50. I thought this was all I would ever need. A notice in the local paper: are you interested in photography? I went along to this meeting set up by Stephen Scott. That was the beginning of what is now Peebles Camera Club. Without Stephen's enthusiasm and generosity and knowledge, I would still be on automode today, I think. I knew something had to give when I was starting to wait for my bridge to write to the card before I could get another shot off. I really thought I would see my days out with this camera. It's up in the loft along with the others. Any offers? 2010, Canon 40D, new to me, stayed with Canon because I found that the lens I had with my old SLRs were both compatible with digital. Tweed green Peebles, one of the very first images I took with my new Canon 40D. In 2012, I joined a Facebook group, Beginners, Amateurs and Novice Photographers. What a great bunch of people. We helped each other out, always passed on anything that we knew that we'd discovered, worked through challenges set, and when the big challenge was thrown into the mix, 365-day challenge. I was up for it, but I didn't realise what it really entailed. There were many times when my dogs were a blessing. The time you sit bolt upright in bed with the realisation that the day had passed and you hadn't taken a shot. You bound out of bed and take another shot of another dog and another day. By this time I was shooting raw and needed to edit each image. With the EXIF, fortunately, I could do this at leisure. My camera was a constant companion during this process, and I learned so much I only wished I could remember it all now. And Lightroom, my saviour for processing. Well, I made it. Buoyed up by this, I thought I would crack on and do another 365. I failed miserably, but without the encouragement of all the members of this Facebook group, I would never have made it alone through the first 365. Our paths still cross now on a regular basis. I also did a daily post to Blip Photo to back up my Facebook entries. This year of photography taught me so very much, firstly about my camera, and secondly about editing all my images. Here is a short video, a collage, for each month of the year. Comments I made at the beginning of the challenge, I know this will be an uphill struggle, but if it makes me get off my fat backside, it is going to be well worth it. And it was. It was around this time I started with different bits of software and filters. I now know less is more. Easy on those sliders, girl. I also discovered that there is a YouTube tutorial for practically anything, especially layers and stitching. Water drops, out of bounds, textures and selective colouring. Textures. When the penny finally dropped using adjustment layers, another forum friend gave me pointers towards textures and where to acquire them. I have always enjoyed the processing part of photography, and this is another step for me. I made many attempts at this one, but I just managed to catch it at the wrong angle. The hat was just behind the parasol pole. I really liked the image and was determined to do something with it, and I just loved the green. It had many faults, as numerous judges had pointed out, and I can only boast a maximum score of 14. It will always be a favourite of mine. In 2016, I joined Pennycook Camera Club and enjoyed the comprehensive programme it offered. I was quite competitive, but I never thought I would be fortunate enough to make club champion, which was 2017-2018 season. I firmly believe this was due to more luck than judgment, or perhaps as the only female member participating with my texture work and horses, my entries were just a little different. At Pennycook, the programme offered studio nights, which gave the opportunity of photographing a model under set conditions. This was set up by Pennycook's very own trotter, Dave Cameron, a super duper lighting man. Looking back at these portraits, they do all seem to be a little generic, as I only seem to shoot head and shoulders. I've never been very comfortable photographing people, and this is probably one reason why I steer away from street photography. It's never really been a favourite of mine. Going back to 2012, we discovered this little caravan site at Cummertrees. It offered amazing views of the Solway with almost a 360-degree panorama. Facing south, across the Solway, views of the Lakeland Fells, glorious sunrises and stunning sunsets and bountiful bird life. The weather is not always conducive to a stay in the caravan. This was the beast from the east in March 2018. Birds, 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 and even more birds. I was fortunate enough to have an almost permanent spot on site and set up feeders and offered attractive landing spots of driftwood, old rope and teasels. A lot of the time the little so-and-sos would choose the barbed wire stringing, much to my frustration. Over the years I used a variety of lens, but I think some of the best results were with the Sigma Contemporary 150-600 lens. I have since sadly parted with this due to the combined weight of camera and lens, which became too cumbersome to handle. In 2019 I traded in my 80D and moved on to the smaller mirrorless camera, but it didn't really make very much difference to the problem of managing the weight. Starlings, the hooligans on the bird feeders. Collared doves, partners for life. I call this little wagtail the fan dancer. And a swallow collecting nesting material. A visit to Eskrig Nature Reserve, always enjoyable, especially squirrel watching. I've never been very good at birds in flight. I think my reactions are a little on the slow side. Capturing seabirds also came with drawbacks. A lot of the time I found the glare from the sea distracting, and getting the right combination of sun and tide right. Facing south, you can be shooting into the sun a lot of the time. I think a lot of the time it just boils down to being in the right place at the right time. Livery stables operated alongside the campsite, and quite often just watching the horses and ponies interact was all the entertainment I needed for the day. excursion to local agricultural shows always meant that I made a beeline for the horses, and as always, the common ridings and rideouts. With textures in mind, I think flowers lend themselves to this process better than anything. You can make your own textures, but I think life is too short. I mostly use French Kiss fine art textures and brushes and overlays by Leslie Nicol. If you subscribe, she offers monthly freebies. And I also use Little Owl fine art textures occasionally. Textures are like presets. Choose something to complement the image, and you can always manipulate it to your liking. This list has evolved a little. I kept my old 60D but traded in my 80D for a Canon mirrorless, an M50. I could never get to grips with this camera. Everything seemed to be in the wrong place, and that bit the dust when a Canon mirrorless M6 Mark II took its place. I found this camera much more user-friendly. As I said before, the big gun had to go. I just couldn't find a Sherpa to carry it. I've never been able to get it right in camera, simply because by the time I had it sorted in my head, it would probably be dark. So I just shoot raw, try not to blow the highlights, use Lightroom for editing, once again my saviour, and Photoshop for the footery bits. Are you awake, Mr. Todd? Mr. Todd, Richard, my photo buddy. We both joined Pennycook Camera Club from the Peebles Camera Club. Peebles were only having 2 meetings a month, and we both felt this really wasn't enough for us. "Are you asleep, Mr. Todd? You may well ask." Richard often fell asleep when the lights went down if the programme got a little boring. Richard was the one that got it right in camera. Every shot was carefully set up, whereas I hit the shutter button and hoped for the best, and hung my hopes on Lightroom. His editing skills were practically non-existent, so what you see is what you get. I've included some of his images here because I've always admired his work, especially his landscapes.